Well, good morning. We're glad you're here today. Just a few announcements. Women's Bible study Tuesday, 7 p.m. at the Stacy's. Men's Bible study Tuesday, 7 p.m. At the Grants. And then helping with dinner at the Union Gospel Mission at 4:30 p.m. this week. Is that Wednesday?
Wednesday.
Youth group is this Thursday at the Grange from 6:30 to 8 p.m. And then a reminder, Andy will be going to India March 5th through the 14th to train pastors with Grace Life Ministries. That's pray for the ministry, pray for Andy. And Andy and Sarah are serving at the Youth Summit weekend at Shiloh Bible Camp March 20th to the 22nd. Please speak with Sarah if you're interested in serving there as well. And also, please encourage any junior high kids in your life to attend. Our scripture reading today is Ezekiel chapter 30. Ezekiel chapter 30. The word of the Lord came again to me, saying, Son of man, prophesy and say, Thus says the Lord God, Wail and alas for the day is near, even the day of the Lord is near. It will be a day of clouds, a time of doom for the nations. A sword will come from Egypt, and anguish will be in Ethiopia. When the slain fall in Egypt, they will take away her wealth, and her foundations are torn down. Ethiopia, Putlud, all Arabia, Libya, and the people of the land that is in the league will fall with them by the sword. Thus says the Lord, indeed those who support Egypt will fall, and the pride of her power will come down. From Migdal to Sion, they will fall within her by the sword, declares the Lord God. They will be desolate in the midst of the desolated lands, and their cities will be in the midst of the devastated cities, and they will know that I am the Lord. When I set a fire in Egypt, and all her helpers are broken. On that day, messengers will go forth from me in ships to frighten, secure Ethiopia, and anguish will be on them on the day of Egypt, for behold, it comes. Thus says the Lord God, I will also make the hordes of Egypt cease by the hand of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon. He and his people with him, the most ruthless of the nations, will be brought in to destroy the land, and they will draw their swords against Egypt and fill the land with the slain. Moreover, I will make the Nile canals dry and sell the land into the hands of the evil men. And I will make the land desolate and all that is in it by the hand of strangers. I, the Lord, have spoken. Thus says the Lord God, I will also destroy the idols and make the images cease from Memphis, and there will no longer be a prince in the land of Egypt. And I will put fear in the land of Egypt, and I will make Pathros desolate, and set a fire in Zoan, and execute judgments on Thebes. I will pour out my wrath on Sin, the stronghold of Egypt. I will also cut off the hordes of Thebes. I will set fire in Egypt, Sin and Rith in anguish. Thebes will be breached, and Memphis will have distresses daily. The young men on of Pi-Beseth will fall by the sword, and the women will go into captivity. The Teophans, the day will be dark, when I break their yokes, bars of Egypt. Then the pride of her power will cease in her. A cloud will cover her, and her daughters will go into captivity. Thus I will execute judgments on Egypt, and they will know that I am the Lord. In the 11th year, in the first month of the 7th of the month, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, Son of man, I have broken the arm of Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and behold, it has not been bound up for healing or wrapped with a bandage, that it may be strong to hold the sword. Therefore, thus says the Lord God, behold, I am against Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and will break his arms, both the strong and the broken, and I will make the sword fall from his hand. I will scatter the Egyptians among the nations and disperse them among the lands, for I will strengthen the arms of the king of Babylon and put my sword in his hand. And I will break the arms of Pharaoh, so that he won't groan before him with the groanings of wounded man. Thus I will strengthen the arms of the king of Babylon, but the arms of Pharaoh will fall. Then they will know that I am the Lord, when I put my sword into the hand of the king of Babylon, and he stretches that out against the land of Egypt, when I scatter the Egyptians among the nations and disperse them among the lands, then they will know that I am the Lord. Andy, would you open us in prayer, please?
Father, we admit that we are so prone to trust in other things, and we look at what you did in Egypt and remember that there were probably many people at that time that thought that something like that could never happen, that Egypt would always be powerful and that they were immune to judgment from you. But you are the God of nations. You sit above all these things as the king, the ruler of the universe. And we understand that has implications for our nation as we see many turning away from you and your truth. I pray that you would use this church in our community and in our nation to reach people with your truth. I ask that people in our land would repent, that they would change their minds about these things. I ask for your mercy, I ask for your grace, and I ask most of all that you would help us not to trust in things that are uncertain, like the future of any Gentile nation, especially one that turns away from you, but that we would instead trust in you, because you are our firm foundation. You are our hope. I ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. If you would take your hymnals and turn to hymn number 520, O Beautiful for Spacious Skies. Let's stay seated. Let's listen to the first verse and prepare hearts for worship in the second hour. Hymn number 520. Stand, please, and let's go ahead and sing all four verses, hymn number 520.
Above the fruited land.
through hymn number 317, Blessed Assurance. Hymn number 317. And let's start right in with the music, and let's sing all three verses. Hymn number 317.
Something we were talking about during Sunday school was the issue of authority. And that's something I'd like to discuss further as we enter our study of 2 Samuel this morning. Authority. Authority is difficult for us, especially when we're given commands that we don't agree with or understand. In our country, I think the most obvious example of this is if you consider our current president and the past president that we had before him. It's hard to imagine two people that had more different visions for what our country would be like. And since about half the country, or a little give or take, has agreed with one president and disagreed with the other, then it's clear that most of our country has lived in the last few years under someone that they disagreed with. And that's an example of having trouble with authority, because when someone's in charge and you don't like what they do, or you don't want to do what they say, that's difficult, isn't it? It's very difficult. And so we understand what that's like from politics, but how about an example that's a little closer to home? What if we thought about a boss that we've had that you didn't like? Or maybe a boss you had that you did like, but you've disagreed with from time to time. Either way, authority is difficult. It's almost like when we're serving under someone's authority, We look at them through a magnifying glass. We get a unique perspective on who they are that we wouldn't have otherwise had if we had served under them in that way. And it magnifies their strengths, but also their weaknesses. And it's difficult when we don't understand. Now, in the passage that we're studying this morning, we're going to see how different people respond to authority. We were studying that last week as well, and we understand that what's happening at this point in 2 Samuel is there's been a rebellion. Absalom has taken over, and that is going to lead to his natural conclusion. When you have two warring factions in one country, the natural conclusion is a civil war that ends with the death of one of their leaders. That's what's going to happen in the passage we're studying today. And as we go through it, we're going to look at this disagreement about who should be in power and how different people responded to those things, to how different people responded to David. And as we think about that, what I'd like us all to have in the back of our minds is understanding that at this time, David was God's anointed on the earth. Well, who is ultimately God's anointed? Who is the Christ? It's Jesus. And so there are some similarities between how people respond to God's appointed authority at that time in Israel and how we respond to Christ, just as we saw last week. Let's do a little bit of review. You remember that we're studying the books of 1 and 2 Samuel, so we've looked at the last judge, Samuel, the first king, Saul, and then the latter part of 1 Samuel and pretty much all of 2 Samuel is about David's reign. And within that, we saw the first 10 chapters, consolidation and conquest. God was blessing David. We saw over and over again, God was with David for his good, for his success. God was exalting David, not through David's own efforts or David's own shrewdness or intelligence, but God was exalting David to this position by his grace, doing these things for David. But then something happened. David sinned. David sinned against God by taking the wife of another man. And then he tried to cover it up. And then when that didn't work, he murdered Uriah by the hands of the Ammonites. And so this was the beginning of a time of trouble in David's life. And that's the section that we're in now. David is experiencing this trouble. We've looked at his secret crimes. We've looked at Nathan the prophet confronting him. We've looked at how David sowed sexual sin and murder in his life. And what did he reap from that? Sexual sin and murder in his family. God saying through Nathan that he was going to raise up evil for David from within his own household. And how David had done this thing secretly and concealed it, but God would discipline David in a public way. And that's what's going on now. David is experiencing these difficulties, ultimately leading to a civil war in Israel. Now, last week we looked at a battle of counselors. When Absalom stole the hearts of the people of Israel out from under the nose of David, and he came in and announced himself king, he announced himself king in Hebron, then he makes his way to Jerusalem. And as he's doing this, David finds out, and David starts to go out of Jerusalem because he loved the city and he didn't want the city to be the place where the conflict would happen. And as he's going out, we saw several people that approached David, different people that wanted to help him, or maybe they wanted something from him, or they just wanted to say, I told you so. One of them was Hushai, and he was a friend of David's, and he succeeded in infiltrating Absalom's administration, his new administration. So now Hushai is there as a helper for David, but there's another counselor other than Hushai. It's Ahithophel, and you remember last week that I explained that Ahithophel has some pretty significant similarities with Judas Iscariot in the New Testament. Ahithophel betrayed David. Ahithophel also hanged himself after he saw the handwriting on the wall, that his advice was not followed and that David was going to come back into power. And so Hushai succeeded in thwarting the counsel of Ahithophel, which is something that David had prayed about previously. God answered that prayer request, maybe not in the way that David intended, but he answered it. And we also saw David's friends working for him, David's friends communicating and bringing him information. So David had these people in his life that God had supplied. And we'll see more of that this week. But the big idea from last week was be loyal to the king. And something that we would all consider is, are we more like Hushai, are we a friend of Christ? Are we someone that cares so much about what Jesus wants to see in our lives that we're willing to do anything for him? Or are we more like Ahithophel, the betrayer? Or maybe somewhere in between, like Peter, the disciple in the New Testament. We want to do what God wants, but we have a fear of man and we deny him sometimes. These are good things to consider, because every person is going to give an account to God's anointed, Jesus Christ. We all have that day coming. And when it comes, you can't go back and live life again. You can't go back and do it again. Okay, so this week, we're going to see two of everything. We got a civil war, so multiple sides. And we're going to see two approaches to David. People that helped David and people that tried to kill David. We're going to see two proposed strategies as David and the people consider how to address this problem of all of Israel coming to fight with them. Obviously, two armies, because we have a civil war. And then we're going to see Joab consider two different options for how to handle a command that David gave him. And we're going to get two memorials for, spoiler, Absalom. Absalom is the leader that dies at the end. And, you know, you probably all knew that, but... Anyway, let's go ahead and get into it with the first passage. And what we're going to see in this passage of the two approaches, there's pursuit and there's consideration. So starting in 2 Samuel 17, verse 24. Then David came to Mahanaim, and Absalom crossed the Jordan, he and all the men of Israel with him. Absalom set Amasa over the army in place of Joab. Now Amasa was the son of a man whose name was Ithra the Israelite, who went in to Abigail, the daughter of Nahash, sister of Zeruiah, Joab's mother. And Israel and Absalom camped in the land of Gilead. Okay, so there's a few places mentioned here. Let's look at where some of these are. So we have Jerusalem down here, and remember that's where David ruled. Now Hebron's not on this map, but it would be down below here. When Absalom announced himself as king, he did so in Hebron, and then he went into Jerusalem. And shortly before that, David exited Jerusalem. Now, the lavender line, it's a little hard to see, but this is David's path. He crosses, he goes east, he crosses the Jordan River, and he goes up here, and goes to Mahanaim. That's where he is. And Absalom and Israel are camped in Gilead. And then we see the forest of Ephraim. That's where the eventual conflict will take place. So it's a little bit interesting to think about how the tables have turned, because you remember when David first came into power, he was king over Judah, not over all Israel. And he was king in Hebron. And his opponent, or Saul's son, Ishbosheth, was king in Mahanaim. Now what you have is Absalom is occupying Jerusalem, and David has been forced over to Mahanaim. And so the tables have turned a little bit. Also, what's something else we see? We see Amasa. Now, this is a little hard to follow. I don't know if you've ever done 23andMe or Ancestry.com or anything like that. I did, and this week, one of my distant relatives got a hold of me and wanted to connect with me. Her name was Betty Brasher. Brasher is my mom's maiden name. And so I was looking at this chart, trying to understand how we're related, and apparently, her father is Clarence Brasher, and that's my great-grandfather's brother. And so I bring that up to say that sometimes it's really complicated when people explain to you how they're related to someone else. It's hard to follow. But I'm going to try to explain this, and let's see if we can make some sense of it. So first we have Zeruiah. That is David's sister, okay? And that's the mother of Joab and Abishai and Asahel. Now, Zeruiah had a sister whose name was Abigail. And this Abigail was the daughter of a man named Nahash. Now, that's a little bit confusing, because we understand that David's dad is Jesse, not Nahash. And so why is Abigail Nahash's daughter? Well, some people think that Jesse may have died and David's mother remarried. That's possible. And if that's the case, it's also possible that Zeruiah was not Jesse's daughter, but Nahash's daughter, because Abigail is called the sister of Zeruiah. Lost yet? Hope not. It's also possible that Abigail was a stepsister of Zeruiah, that she was actually Nahash's child from a previous relationship. And in any case, Abigail is only called Zeruiah's sister. It's interesting she's not called David's sister. Now, what happened with this? Well, Amasa's father is called Ithra the Israelite in this passage. You see that there. Now, Amasa was the son of a man whose name was Ithra the Israelite. This is further complicated by a passage in 1 Chronicles 2, verse 17, that says that Amasa's father was Jethro the Ishmaelite. So which is so? Well, there's a textual conflict there, and we're already dealing with problems of our own, so we're not going to get into that today. But in any case, what happened, it says that Ithra the Israelite went in to Abigail, the daughter of Nahash. Now that's an interesting phrase because it doesn't say that they were married, and the implication is that they had this child not being married. And so he went in to Abigail, and that produced Amasa. And so the main point is Amasa is the illegitimate cousin of Joab. And by extension, he's even more distantly related to David, though not more legitimately conceived. And on David's deathbed, David actually had this to say about Amasa, that he was a good man. So Amasa is put in charge by Absalom. Main point, Amasa is distantly related to Absalom. Okay, so we have this first approach. All that's going on here is Absalom is pursuing David. But there were other people in Israel that had a very different approach. And they are these men that we'll read about here, starting in verse 27 through verse 29. Now when David had come to Mahanaim, Shobi, the son of Nahash, from Rabbah, of the sons of Ammon, Machir, the son of Amiel, from Lodibar, and Barzillai, the Gileadite, from Rogalim, brought beds, basins, pottery, wheat, barley, flour, parched grain, beans, lentils, parched seeds, honey, curds, sheep, and cheese of the herd for David and for the people who were with him to eat. For they said, "The people are hungry and weary and thirsty in the wilderness." So who are these people? Well, Shobi, that's a vassal king under David. You may remember, if you have been with us for a little while, that David has had conflict with the Ammonites. And what happened is that he was kind to Nahash, who is the first king. And what happened in 2 Samuel earlier on when we were studying is Nahash died and his son Hanun came in his place. And David said, well, I'll be kind to him because his dad died. I'll show kindness to him. So he sends these counselors over them, and Hanun gets advice from some of his counselors, and they say, you think that David's being nice to you, but really he's just spying out the land because your dad died and he sensed his weakness and he's going to take over. And so what does Hanun do? Well, he shaved half the guy's beards off and he cut their garments short, gave them mini skirts, and he sent them away. Now this obviously made David angry, and that was the beginning of a big conflict. Now that's not who is in charge now. Who's in charge now is Shobi. And so apparently the friendship between David and the sons of Ammon has been restored after tremendous conflict. So that's Shobi. And then we have Machir, the son of Amiel from Lodibar. Now we've actually heard of him before. In 2 Samuel 9, we saw that he was the one that was giving shelter to Mephibosheth. Let's read that passage. 2 Samuel 9, you remember when David was trying to show kindness. 2 Samuel 9, verse 1. Then David said, is there yet anyone left of the house of Saul that I may show kindness for Jonathan's sake? Verse 3, the king said, is there not yet anyone of the house of Saul to whom I may show the kindness of God? And Ziba, that was Saul's old servant, said to the king, there is still a son of Jonathan who is crippled in both feet. So the king said to him, where is he? And Ziba said to the king, behold, he is in the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, in Lodibar. Then King David sent and brought him from the house of Machir, the son of Amiel, from Lodibar. And so this is the same man, one of the same people that is now helping David. And that's interesting. Machir was someone who gave Mephibosheth care, who sheltered him. And Machir maybe remembered that the reason that he wasn't doing that anymore is because of David's previous kindness to Mephibosheth. That is interesting because Absalom was effective in taking the throne because he sowed so much propaganda. But there was a problem there, and that is that this man knew David, and the propaganda didn't have the effect on others that it would on him, because he knew David to be someone who was kind. He knew David to be the kind of person that would do something for the crippled son of his previous enemy. Not many people would do something like that. And so Machir knew what kind of man David was. And then you get the third person is Barzillai the Gileadite. And we'll actually read a little bit more later on in 2 Samuel about him. He's an interesting person. Now, what do these men do? Look at all those supplies they brought. And unlike Ziba, who had done this for David before when David was being exiled, when he was on his way out of Jerusalem, Ziba did that because he had something to gain. These men do this for a different reason. And look at the consideration involved. They brought all of the kinds of things that people would need if they were stuck in the wilderness. Beds and basins, pottery, wheat, all these foodstuffs. Everything that would be needed to supply for a people, and all just without necessarily anything to gain. Why did they do this? Well, they say why they do it. It says in the last verse, they said the people are hungry and weary and thirsty in the wilderness. So they did this because they saw a need. That's interesting. You know, how many of these men would have thought the previous year that there would be a need like this that would come into their little corner of the earth? And yet God does that sometimes. He puts opportunities for service in front of us, sometimes unexpected in this way. And these men were ready. They were prepared. Not to do it because they had something to gain, but they did it because they saw a need and because they understood something about what was going on with the conflict, that David was God's anointed, not Absalom. See, the very thing that everyone accused David of being, a usurper who stole the throne, people thought that about David. Absalom actually was that. He was that, and these men understood what was going on, and they helped David, and that must have meant a lot to David, especially at this time. Now, going on, we see beyond the two approaches to David, pursuit or consideration, now we're going to see two different strategies that David and the people consider as they face this conflict. You remember that Hushai had bought David some time by saying to Absalom, "You need to get all the people, round all the people up." And it took time to do that, and it gave Hushai time to warn David about what was coming. But now Absalom has succeeded in rounding all the people up, and they're going to go after David in a big way. And so they're considering how to do this. So starting in chapter 18, verses 1 and 2. "Then David numbered the people who were with him and sent over them commanders of thousands and commanders of hundreds. David sent the people out, one-third under the command of Joab, one-third under the command of Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, Joab's brother, and one-third under the command of Ittai, the Gittite. And the king said to the people, 'I myself will surely go out with you also.'" And so after being refreshed, after David and his people have received these supplies, they begin preparing for conflict. And so what does David do? He organizes the people. And because they have three commanders, you can maybe assume that there was about 3,000 people, because it says that he set commanders of thousands, and I think that those are named here with Joab and Abishai and Ittai the Gittite. Now, we know Joab pretty well, Abishai his brother. We have seen him before, and you remember Ittai the Gittite? He was only mentioned one time before. He was the man that I compared to Ruth when we studied him, because David said, as they're going out of Jerusalem, "You don't have to go with me, man. I mean, you just joined us yesterday." He has all these people that have been following him for years and years and years, have been committed to him, and he gives this man from Gath, the Gittite, this opportunity. "You don't have to. You can leave." And what did Ittai do? Ittai committed to following David. He was loyal to David. Didn't matter to him that he had only been there a short while. He cared about David. And so David rewards him here. He sees that this is a man that he can trust, and he appoints him to a position in leadership. Now, part of David's strategy, though, is to go into battle with the people. That's what he wanted to do. But that's not what happened. That's not what happened. And this is interesting because you can recall many other times in David's life, as we studied 1 and 2 Samuel, where God held him back from being in a battle or held him back from doing something that would have been bad for him. I think of Nabal and Abigail. David heard that Nabal, this man in the wilderness, had sheep shearers, and he sent messengers to get some supplies. And Nabal totally disrespected David's messengers and David. So David gets word, and what does he do? He kind of flips out a little bit, and he decides that he's going to go and kill Nabal. And what happens? Abigail comes in, one woman versus lots of burly, scary looking soldiers. She solves the whole situation. It was awesome. And David did not kill Nabal. Now, another instance is Saul and Jonathan's death. You remember that when Saul and Jonathan died, David was actually with the Philistines at the rear guard, at the army, going marching toward the place where Saul and Jonathan were going to die. And the Philistine lords say, hey, we don't want him in the back. We don't want him there where something could potentially go wrong, because what if he has an issue with loyalty? And so they wanted him to stay behind. And so God orchestrated that so that David was not there when Saul and Jonathan died. And you see similar things with Ishbosheth's death, another one of Saul's sons who had reigned as king, Abner's death. David was often held back by God from being involved in some of these situations because that was what was best for him. And there's a lesson to be learned there, and that is that God doesn't need our help to accomplish things in our life. In fact, some of the most important things he does for us do not involve our works. Specifically, I have in mind salvation. Salvation is a gift from God that is not by our works. Otherwise, we could boast about it. It's something that he does for us that we merely accept by faith. So we see that God is working in a similar way here in David's life. He is holding David back because what happens? Well, the people suggest a different strategy. Reading from verse 3. But the people said, you should not go out, for if we indeed flee, they will not care about us. Even if half of us die, they will not care about us. But you are worth 10,000 of us. Therefore, now it is better that you be ready to help us from the city. Then the king said to them, whatever seems best to you, I will do. So the king stood beside the gate, and all the people went out by hundreds and thousands. The king charged Joab and Abishai and Ittai, saying, deal gently for my sake with the young man Absalom. And all the people heard when the king charged all the commanders concerning Absalom. And so what's the argument of the people? They say, basically, David, you're like the king on the chessboard. And if they get you, it's all over. Doesn't matter how many other pieces they take out, that doesn't matter. Because if you get killed, this whole thing is over. And so they understood. And that was true. That was true for David. That was also true for Absalom. If one of them died, basically the conflict was over. And so they say, stay here and play air control from the city. David wisely listens. And there's a lesson there too. You see that David was in a position of authority. He could have decided that he wanted to do it differently. And when we're in a position of authority, we need to be wise like this and understand that sometimes other people might have better ideas than we do, and we need to listen. Now, he stands aside. He's standing at the gate of Mahanaim, and he's watching all these people go out. What a humbling experience that must have been, and difficult to watch all these people going out of the city that are fighting for you while you're staying there. And David does that. And then also think about what a blessing that is, though, that God had provided all of these people that were faithful to David, that were loyal to him. But before he lets them all go out, he gives one final command. Okay? And it was in the hearing of all the people. Now, this is something that he did before. Look back at 2 Samuel 16, verse 9. This is when Shimei was throwing rocks at David and calling him all those nasty names. And Abishai, Joab's brother, said this in 2 Samuel 16, verse 9. Then Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, said to the king, why should this dead dog curse my lord the king? Let me go over now and cut off his head. And if you know Abishai, you know that that's just a very typical response for Abishai or Joab, for that matter. But the king said, what do I have to do with you, O sons of Zeruiah? If he curses, and if the Lord has told him curse David, then who shall say, why have you done so? Then David said to Abishai and to all his servants, notice that part there, to all his servants, behold, my son who came out from me seeks my life. How much more now this Benjamite? Let him alone and let him curse, for the Lord has told him. Perhaps the Lord will look on my affliction and return good to me instead of his cursing this day. So David and his men went on the way, and Shimei went along on the hillside parallel with him. And as he went, he cursed and cast stones and threw dust at him. So what's going on there? Abishai and Joab are just dangerous people. Most of the people that crossed them at some point ended up dead. That happens over and over again. It's not done happening. Not even after we're done studying this chapter is that done happening. And so what David had adapted was a new technique. Now, instead of just telling them, hey, that guy, don't kill him. You don't. No, that's not what he would do anymore. Now he would have a team meeting and make it accountable to everyone. So he brought everyone in. He did that with Abishai. Now he does it with Abishai and Joab. He says in the hearing of all the people, everyone could hear it. Team meeting, deal gently with Absalom. Deal gently with Absalom. Everyone heard the same thing. That's intended to produce accountability. David is probably thinking of Saul's own treatment of him as he's thinking about this. He does not want Absalom to be treated like that. But there is a difference, though, and that is that David is God's anointed. Absalom is a murdering usurper. That's what Absalom is. And so Absalom is what the enemies of David said that David was. Nonetheless, this is the command of the king. This is what he says. And now we see the two armies. Reading from 2 Samuel 18, verse 6. Then the people went out into the field against Israel, and the battle took place in the forest of Ephraim. The people of Israel were defeated there before the servants of David, and the slaughter there that day was great, 20,000 men. For the battle was spread over the whole countryside, and the forest devoured more people that day than the sword devoured. So you remember I mentioned this earlier. Where are these places? Well, this is Gilead, the general area where Absalom was camped. Mahanaim, that's where David was. Here's Roglim and Lodabar. That's where these men were that helped David. And there is the battle. And the terrain actually played a big part in this. So David's forces were victorious, but something is not stated in these verses, and that is you don't see David or Absalom die. And so even though David's forces were victorious, as the people have said before, that doesn't really matter. Because what matters is either David or Absalom has to die. Nonetheless, they are victorious. 20,000 are dead in this civil war. That's never really a cause for rejoicing. That was probably a mournful day. And the battle spreads out over this large area. And it says that the forest actually devoured more people than the sword, which is interesting. That indicates that in some way it seems like God is helping David in an unstated way. Now, there's an example of how that happened. You might think, how could the forest devour people? Well, if you've ever been hunting and stuck in the woods, you can understand something about how a forest could get at people. But God gives us an example in 2 Samuel 18, starting in verse 9. All right, reading from there. Now Absalom happened to meet the servants of David. For Absalom was riding on his mule, and the mule went under the thick branches of a great oak, and his head caught fast in the oak. So he was left hanging between heaven and earth, while the mule that was under him kept going. And so Absalom is riding through the forest. He's running from the men of Israel on his royal steed, the mule. And what happens? Well, he's an example of how the forest got people on that day. And there is a question regarding the interpretation of this text. The word that's translated head could also be translated hair. And you remember from early on in 2 Samuel, Absalom had a nice, thick head of hair. He had a lot of hair. He was someone who could grow so much hair that at the end of the year he would cut it and he'd have just this big pile of hair. And that was his practice. He would cut it once annually. And so it's the same Hebrew word that's translated head in this verse and hair in 2 Samuel 14. So I think that is likely that Absalom was actually trapped by his hair, which is a little bit ironic because that was something that he was proud of. And now he's hanging by it in a tree, stuck there. What Absalom was proud of became his downfall. And so now he's trapped. They got him dead to rights. And what happens? Look in verse 10. When a certain man saw it, he told Joab and said, "Behold, I saw Absalom hanging in an oak." Then Joab said to the man who had told him, "Now behold, you saw him? Why then did you not strike him there to the ground? And I would have given you 10 pieces of silver and a belt." The man said to Joab, "Even if I should receive 1,000 pieces of silver in my hand, I would not put out my hand against the king's son. For in our hearing, the king charged you and Abishai and Ittai, saying, 'Protect for me the young man Absalom. Otherwise, if I had dealt treacherously against the king, and there is nothing hidden from the king, then you yourself would have stood aloof." And so what happens? This soldier sees Absalom in this very embarrassing position and vulnerable, and he reports it to Joab. He must have been under Joab's command. And at this point, we know Joab well enough that we should be able to predict what his response is going to be. And so he snaps at the soldier. "Why didn't you finish him off? Why did you let him be?" He's astonished that this soldier saw Absalom in that position and let him live, because that's not what Joab would have done. And then he says, "I would have rewarded you." Now, obviously, this soldier knew Joab pretty well, too, probably better than us, because he says, "There's no reward worth disobeying the king." And he reminds Joab of that little team meeting they had, you remember, that was in all the hearing of the people. Everyone heard the same thing at once: deal gently with the young man Absalom for my sake. And he even tells Joab, "You know what? Even if you did this and I got a reward, I killed Absalom and I got a reward, the king would find out, and you yourself would throw me under the bus," basically is what he's saying. If the king found out and decided that he was going to execute me, you would stand off like nothing happened and just watch that all play out, wouldn't you, Joab? Yeah, that's exactly what Joab would do. So what does Joab do? He gets stabby. Look at verse 14. "Then Joab said, 'I will not waste time with you here.'" I just find that hilarious. I could think of like one of our, that's like something Nancy Pelosi would say, like, "I won't waste time with you." And so moving on, "So he took three spears in his hand and thrust them through the heart of Joab while he was yet alive in the midst of the oak. And 10 young men who carried Joab's armor gathered around and struck Absalom and killed him. Then Joab blew the trumpet and the people returned from pursuing Israel, for Joab restrained the people." So this is very characteristic of Joab. "I'm not going to waste time here discussing with you theoretical situations when there is someone that I want to be dead that is not yet dead." So Joab goes to take care of that. And he takes three spears. Why three? This is kind of like those people that, like, you hear about someone crossed the Clintons and they were found in their hotel room having committed suicide by shooting themselves three times in the back of the head with their left hand, even though they were right-handed, you know. Why is that a characteristic when you really want someone to die that you do it like that? Well, that's the reason for the three spears. He wants to make sure that Absalom gets dead. And so he goes in with a little bit of overkill. Three spears to make sure that it gets done. And Joab does what he has done before and what he will do again. He takes someone out. In this case, Absalom. And so you can imagine him like in a room like this, maybe about this height, that Absalom was riding on a mule and he had been caught and he's hanging up there by his hair. And Joab takes these spears and he just skewers them, kills them. And if that wasn't enough, he has 10 helpers that also take part in this and also help him just to make sure. They made sure, absolutely sure, that he was dead. Because just as the people understood that the death of David was the death of their cause, so Joab understood that the death of Absalom was the end of their struggle. And so that's what he did. Most people who ended up on the wrong side of Joab end up dead. But now the deed's done. Joab blows the horn and reins in his people. And everyone is coming back. The conflict's over. Absalom is dead. And then what do we get? Well, we're not going to go into what happens to Joab today. But we do get two memorials in this case. Reading from verses 17 and 18. "They took Absalom and cast him into a deep pit in the forest and erected over him a very great heap of stones. And all Israel fled, each to his tent. Now Absalom in his lifetime had taken and set up for himself a pillar, which is in the king's valley. For he said, 'I have no son to preserve my name.' So he called the pillar after his own name, and it is called Absalom's monument to this day." So we have two memorials. One that Joab and the people gave Absalom, and one that Absalom gave himself. The first one's not really a memorial, much of a memorial, really. They just unceremoniously chucked Absalom's corpse in a hole in the woods, is what they did. And they made a great mound of rocks over it because they have this whole army there, and so you have a lot of people that can put heavy things on top, and they basically made sure that no one would dig him up and do what probably he would have preferred would be done, or do what would have been done if any one of the king's other sons had died, which would be that they would be taken back to Jerusalem or possibly Bethlehem and buried in a place where their family was buried. That's not what Joab wanted to happen. And so they dishonored Absalom even in his death. And at this point, all the opposing forces scatter and all Israel fled, each to his tent. And now we get the second memorial. This is a little different. This is the memorial that Absalom set up for himself, and that's the point. Absalom didn't have someone in his life that was going to carry on a good memory of him. What's interesting is that we learned earlier in 2 Samuel that Absalom did in fact have three sons, but by this time, apparently they have either died prematurely or been estranged from him in some way, because when he sets up the memorial, he says, "I have no sons. I have no sons to carry on my name," is what he's saying. Now, in Israel, it was a custom at that time that if someone had a father who was famous and they died, that they would set up a memorial like this one that Absalom set up for himself. But he set it up for himself. Why did he do that? Because he lived poorly, he died badly, and no one cared enough about him to do something like that for him. And that's the reminder. That's Absalom's monument. They actually have one that's in a similar place today. It's not the same one, but it probably stands in the same place. And what it is it's a monument that's a reminder of the consequences of selfish ambition and a lack of faith in God. That's what Absalom's monument reminds us of. And as I thought about that, I remembered this verse in 1 Peter as well. 1 Peter chapter 5. You think about the pride of Absalom, and in this case, the humility of David, who was willing to let the Lord work for him. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verses 6 and 7, and verses 10 and 11, it says this: "Therefore, humble yourselves under the mighty hand of God, that he may exalt you at the proper time, casting all your anxiety on him because he cares for you. After you have suffered for a little while, the God of all grace, who called you to his eternal glory in Christ, will himself perfect, confirm, strengthen, and establish you. To him be dominion forever and ever. Amen." So as we think about Absalom's life, we saw someone that had a very typical outlook on life, an outlook that many people have today, and that is that seize the day, seize everything that you can, take what you can get, make out of life what you can, what you're able to do. And this is not an attitude of trusting God and understanding that he will exalt you at the proper time. God's going to do that for you. God's going to respond positively to you if you're humble, if you're not like everyone else in the world that is trying to claw their way to the top. And that isn't to say that we shouldn't take advantage of opportunities that come our way, because we should, but it's not that we should live a prideful life like Absalom lived. And so the question then that we could ask ourselves is this: are we loyal to Jesus even when it's hard? Even when it's really hard. And we have so many examples of that in the text that we just read. We had Absalom pursuing David, trying to take him out, just as Saul had done before. But look at Absalom's end. Look at what happened with how he lived. What happened to him? Destruction. That is the end of those who set themselves against the Lord's anointed. It is shame and destruction. Then we also have the example of David's men versus Israel. What did Israel do? They, for the most part, all went after Absalom. They did the popular thing. They fell for the propaganda. They followed the crowd. What did David's men do? They swam upstream. They did something that was different than what everyone around them was doing, because they were loyal to David, because they understood that he was God's anointed. They were in line with God's purposes. That's why they did that. And being loyal to Jesus, even when it's hard, I think the best example of that in this passage of someone having to decide whether to be loyal to God's anointed is Joab, obviously. Joab was told by David, don't do this one thing. What's the one thing that Joab did? Joab is an example of someone, and we do this too. We think, in this area of my life, I know better. I know something different, and I don't have to do it what everyone else says the right way. I don't have to do it what God's word says is the right way, because I understand this better than God. Now, we don't actually articulate that, but that's what we're doing with our actions when we do something like what Joab did here. And they are our examples. That's the applications today. From David, what do we learn? God doesn't need you to do everything. In fact, the most important things in our life, God doesn't need you to accomplish them at all. He accomplished them in Christ. We receive that merely by faith, by trusting in what Jesus has done on our behalf. And David's life at different times is an example of how God works for people, which, by the way, that's different than all the false religions in the world. How many of those religions are a religion where God works for you? No. In Christianity, Christ died for you. In Islam, you die for Allah. In many other religions, that's how it works. But in our faith, Christ died for us. And David is an example of that. Then we saw the example of Shobi and Machir and Barzillai. These guys had an unexpected opportunity for service that came up, and they followed through on it. And I think that's worth emulating in our lives. We saw how the armies had to make a decision, and man, in our culture, like, what's popular is now becoming what's oppressive. Like, it's hard to go against the grain. It's hard to make the decision that we know is right when everyone around us is saying, no, it has to be a different way. In fact, the forces that oppose God in our culture are developing dogma, doctrine. Yeah, I can see a time in the not-too-distant future where a young Christian might not even be accepted in a university because of the things that they believe. And they'll be more stringent about their doctrine than any Christian university ever was about its own doctrine. Choosing the right side. We learned that from the armies of David. And we covered Joab. Serving in the Lord's army means obedience to his anointed, even when we think we know a better way. And that's what Joab thought. He thought he knew a better way than David. And ultimately, we ended with Absalom and that example. Now, for the unbeliever, of course, we understand the consequence of setting yourself against Christ and not trusting in him for salvation is eternal separation from God. For the believer, for the one who has received eternal life as a free gift that can never be lost or taken away, we can still experience consequences when we set ourselves against God. We can still experience shame and destroyed lives. And I think that there's many examples of that in the Bible, and probably people that we know, maybe even some of us, have reaped those consequences, as David reaped consequences in 2 Samuel. And so that's something that we need to avoid. Let's take these examples to heart, and let's have a word of prayer together. Father, I pray that you would help us to understand your word. Help us to understand how it applies to our lives in a practical way. We understand that all scripture is inspired by you and profitable, and we understand that this scripture is profitable. I pray that we would take into our hearts the examples of these people and consider where they led, consider what their decisions led to. I especially pray that you would give us strength to be loyal to Christ in a world that is increasingly oppressive toward those who are open about faith in Christ. Give us strength in this way. I ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, so the last song today is going to be one that's not in the hymnal. So if you give me a second to change the slide, and then we'll sing it together. Okay, please stand, and I'm going to play just a little bit of this song, and then we will sing it together.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Oh, my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. The sun comes up.
Scripture today of encouragement is Romans chapter 8, verses 38 and 39. For I am convinced that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing will be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Have a great Sunday. Thank you.